Today's the day. We get to see how the ending of this book goes and figure out, hopefully it seems like it's gonna be a pretty happy ending, to a terrible story. So let's see what happens. And by terrible story, I mean tragic story. So they have just seen Uncle Swimming Bear and Talk Boy and Aunt Key are all there, and he's talking about being excited about living in the village, in the new village. He's already started building his house, and he says he'll teach me how he fishes. And shh, Uncle Swimming Bear interrupted Hawk Boy. Tomorrow's travel will be long. Soft rain needs rest. He lifted Hawk Boy down from the wagon. Then, before he also jumped out, Uncle Swimming Bear whispered, "I found a puppy for you, Soft Rain." What can make a better ending than a puppy? Love a puppy. You know how much I love puppies. Because I've gotten three this year. I found a puppy for you, Soft Rain. She's brown. Hawk Boy says you'll need this. He laid Pet's rope across Soft Rain's lap. Shivering with excitement, she touched the rope. Then she felt inside the pocket of the dress. Grandmother's doll was still there. Lying down, she pulled the blanket over her. But sleep didn't come. Instead, memories of the past year whirled round and round inside her head. Father said that tomorrow we will be home in the West. The journey has been hard. How long we have traveled, I cannot remember. But I will ask Aunt Key, for I want to know. I want to tell the story about why we left our beautiful mountain home and how we traveled to the West. In the story, I will tell about Pet and grandmother who were left behind, about Green Fern who died, about old roving man who vanished, and about the soldiers and the doll. I'll begin. When I was a young girl, the soldiers came. We cried and cried, sad to leave our home and our loved ones. We traveled west across rivers, valleys, and mountains. The end. That was the end of the story. What do you think? What are you thinking? Was that a good way for the author to end that story? I think so. They finally arrived. Some of their family that they didn't expect to be there was there. Uncle Swimming Bear. And she found her father and her brother. She's gonna have a puppy. So, a very tragic story, but a good ending to that story. I can't imagine what it must have been like for the Indians on the Trail of Tears and how many of them passed away and how many survived. It's a real part of our history and a sad part of our history. There's an afterword. Sometimes a book has an afterword with additional information. We are going to read that today because it talks about the Cherokee Nation. In November of 1785, a treaty between the Cherokee Nation and the U.S. government was signed. This hopeful treaty solemnly guaranteed forever the boundary between the Cherokee Nation and that of the United States and placed the Cherokees under the protection of the U.S. government. Just 6 years later, the white settlers were already crossing the lines set by this treaty. The history of the Cherokee Nation is one of constant struggle to enforce its rightful boundaries. As early as 1875, the U.S. government had begun its attempts to relocate the Cherokees to the West. In exchange for their eastern land, the Cherokees would receive an equal area in Arkansas. But those who chose not to move were soon evicted, so they were forced to leave. By 1825, the majority of Tennessee Cherokees had already been forced out. Between 1828 and 1830, the Georgia state government enacted a series of laws that annexed all Cherokees that had to leave. Then later distributed the land through lottery to white citizens, so just giving it to them, annulled all laws and ordinances of the Cherokee Nation, closed Cherokee courts, and forbade all political gatherings. The Cherokees reluctantly left their tribal capital of the new Oakota, moving their government to Red Clay, Tennessee. But it was in 1835 that the most tragic episode in Cherokee history began. The Treaty of New Oakota, signed by several members of the newly formed Cherokee Treaty Party, surrendered all remaining Cherokee land east of the Mississippi River on May 17, 1837. The treaty was formally approved by the U.S. Congress. 6 days later, it was signed by President Andrew Jackson. The Cherokees were given 2 years to remove themselves. Despite a protest letter signed by nearly 16,000 Cherokee men, women, and children, the treaty was upheld. A military headquarters was established at New Akota and enforced the relocation. Between October and November of 1838, the greater part of the Cherokee Nation took final leave of its beloved homeland. Approximately 1,400 Cherokees did not remove, but chose to hide through the severe winter in hills and caves. Of the 18,000 who left, some 4,000 died in stockades or on the trail before the last group arrived in Oklahoma on March 25, 1839. Today, there are about 85,000 tribal members of the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. The eastern band of Cherokee Nation, mostly residing in North Carolina and descended from those Cherokees who escaped the relocation, soldiers, numbers more than 9,000. The Cherokee name is a mystery. Zaligi may come from salu, meaning tobacco, and agwili, old or ancient, ancient tobacco people. Or it may be derived from Atisiligigai, which means red firemen. The color red was the Cherokee emblem of bravery, and bravery was believed to come from the east where the sun rose. If this is so, Zaligi may mean children of the sun or brave men. Do you know if you have any Cherokee blood or any Cherokee family members, or if you are part Cherokee? More than likely you have some in you if you are from North Carolina or your family is from North Carolina, because that this is partly where they resided, and they also did in the Tennessee mountains. But it's more than likely that you do have Cherokee ancestors. So very, very good story. I hope you enjoyed it, and I can't wait for our next read aloud. Bye, guys.